Good morning, friends. Today we'll discuss regarding the evidences of evolution. Yesterday we have seen that evolution is an everlasting process and it is a gradual change in the structure and the functional organization of the animal. Now, how do we say there should be some proof to understand that the theory, to support the theory of evolution? Here we are going to see the six evidences which supports the theory of evolution. The first one we'll see now, morphological evidence. Now, morphology means the things which we see with our eyes. For example, structure, position of the structure of the mouth, position of the eyes, suppose structure of the nostrils, then ear pinna, the hairs, distribution of the hairs on the body. So these are the things which we see with our naked eyes on the structure of the animal. So they are called as morphological structures. Whereas similarities, if you see the characters like shape of the leaves, then you can say venation. Venation means the marks which are there on the leaves. There are two types of venation, reticulate venation and parallel venation. Reticulate venation, where a single primary vein will be there to which you will see a secondary anterior veins will be there. Whereas parallel venation means if you see the venations in case of the sugarcane, leaves of the sugarcane, or you can say the maize leaf, they have parallel venation. So these structures, the similarities in the characters like leaf shape, leaf venation, leaf petiole, etc., they occur in case of plants. This indicates that they are having these similarities in their structures that show they belong to the same group, and therefore we can prove that their origin must be same and they must have common ancestors. What you have to remember here, that morphological evidences, these evidences, these are the proofs, or we can say these are the characteristics which help us or which support the theory of evolution, where these all have generated from the common ancestors. When you are writing this paragraph, you have to remember this last line, that the similarities in the structures and the characteristics, we can say that it proves that origin must be same. Origin must be same, that means they are being evolved from the common ancestors. So morphological evidence is one of the supporting proof to support the theory of evolution. Morphology, the structures which we see on the animals as well as in the plants. So that suggests that they belong to the common ancestors. Now, second evidence which we are going to support this theory of evolution, that is anatomical evidence. Now, anatomy means study regarding the bones. If you see the structures, now give an example, hand of the human, cat's foreleg, then patagium of bat, flipper of whale. If you see the structures carefully, you will see certain similarity between the human hand, then the cat's foreleg, the flipper of the whale, and patagium of bat. Now similarly, use of each of these structure is different in the respective animal. The for what purpose we are using the hand, the foreleg of the cat or the flipper of the whale, their functions in different organisms, they are being different. But if you see the structure of their bones and arrangement of the bones, the joints in the organ of each of these animal, there will be similarity. And this similarity indicates that these animals, they are being evolved from the common ancestor. So that is a proof that we all are having a common origin. So the last line here that is important, the similarity in the structure of the arrangement of these bones in these animals, even though their function is different in different animal, but their arrangement of the structure or arrangement of the bones is similar. So there is a similarity in the arrangement that shows that they have common ancestor. So that is, they are belonging to a common origin. Vestigial organs. Now, third evidence is vestigial organ. Now, what do you mean by vestigial organs? these organs, vestigial organs, we can define that the degenerated or underdeveloped useless organs of organisms, they are called as vestigial organs. That means they are underdeveloped or they might be useless or they might be degenerated in the organism. They are called as vestigial organs. Now, in living organisms, sudden development of new tissues, new immediate development of new tissues or the organs for living in the changing environment, it was not possible. So what is the solution for that? Instead of going for the new organ or immediate new tissue, what we decided, they had the existing organs will undergo a gradual change. Gradual change means step by step, slowly change in the existing organs, which will support that animal to exist in that situation. So most of the specific structure in the body, they are being useful under this situation. For example, you take same structure under different situation may become useless or even harmful. So such structure, if there is useless or it is harmful, they start degenerating. That means they start getting extincted under such situation. And according to the principle of natural selection, what I told you before, that nature selects the species which can adjust in that environment. It requires thousands of years for that organ or that structure to get disappear. Such organs, they are being seen in different phases of disappearance in the different animals. The organs which are, they are non-functional in certain organism, but they may prove very much functional in other organism. That is not vestigial in other organisms, which are not on use. Suppose, for example, you take appendix. Now, appendix, it is there in human being, which was very much useful in our olden, during the ancestors, where they used to eat the raw food, and that raw food was easily digested with the help of appendix. But now, as we are using the boiled one, now our body structure, present body structure, you will see appendix is useless to a human being. And it is useful and fully functional in the organs of ruminant, that means our dead ancestors. Similarly, the muscles of ear pinna, they are not used in human beings, but they are useful for the monkeys for movement of their ear pinna. So various organs like tailbone, wisdom teeth means akkal daat, they are being, or the hairs on the body. Now previously our ancestors, they are having lot of, the body was covered with the hairs. Why? Because they used to live in the forest, jungles. And they never used to wear the clothes, but now we are having the clothes, for various types of clothes for our protection. The role of hairs is to protect the body. So the number of hairs presently on the body of the human being, they are quite less as compared to what they were present before. So these structures, they are called as vestigial organs. They might be non-functional, they might be useless in some organism. At the same time, they are useful in other organism. These degenerated or underdeveloped useless organs of organisms, they are called as vestigial organs. And these vestigial organs, they suggest, or that is also one of the proof that we are being originated from the common origin. For example, you take ear pinna, that is being useful for the monkeys, but it is not useful for us. Appendix, which was used in our own days, but now it is not useful. So that is a proof that we are having a common origin. Now the fourth evidence we'll see today, that is paleontological evidence. Now what do you mean by paleontology? Paleontology is nothing but the study of fossils. Now what are fossils? These are the organisms, plant animals, which are buried inside the soil after the death. So a question arises in our mind that which organisms were existed millions of years ago. We say dinosaurs were existing, but how do we come to know that dinosaurs were present in this, on this earth? That is by studying their fossils. Large number of organisms, they get buried due to the disasters like flood, earthquake, volcano. So natural disasters which come suddenly, when these organisms, they get buried, after their death, their impressions, remnants and impressions of such organisms, they remain preserved underground, and these are nothing but fossils. Study of fossils is one of the important aspect in the study of evolution. Study of fossils is called as paleontology. So, paleontological evidence help us to understand the theory of evolution. It supports the theory of evolution. Now, the method that was called as carbon dating. It was an important method which was developed by scientist Willard Libbe, and he was being awarded with the Nobel Prize in 1960 for his invention. Because of this carbon dating method, we were able to calculate the age of the material determined by understanding the carbon dating. And that carbon dating method, there C14 carbon was being used. Because of this method, we can understand the age of the animal. We can understand the age of the tree. For example, we say that this tree, banyan tree, is right from 400 years ago. But how can we calculate that? Is because of this method C14, that is carbon dating method, and he was awarded with the Nobel Prize. Now, carbon consumption of animals and plants, this stops after death, and since then only the decaying process starts. But the C14, there are two isotopes, C12 and C14. So C14 carbon occurs, decaying process of C14, it occurs continuously. In case of dead bodies of plants and animals, instead of remaining constant, the ratio between the C14 and C12 goes on changing continuously, because the carbon-12 is non-radioactive while carbon-14 is radioactive. The time passed since the death of the plant or animal, that can be calculated by measuring the radioactivity of the C14, and the ratio of C14 and C12 which is present in their body. What I want to tell you here is that C12 is abundantly present in nature. C14 is a radioactive isotope of carbon. So this C12, as soon as the organism dies, the C12, it remains constant, but the C14, it goes on decaying. So the ratio of C12 to C14 or C14 to C12, it goes on changing continuously. And by understanding the ratio of between these two carbons, we can calculate the age or the time passed since the death of the plant or animal. And this method is called as carbon dating method. It is highly useful in paleontology and anthropology for determining the age of human fossils and the manuscripts. Once the age of the fossil has been determined by such technique, it becomes easy for us to understand or could calculate or deduce the information about other organisms. And from the study of this paleontological evidence, it was observed that the vertebrates, they are being slowly originated from the invertebrates. Now, you know what are vertebrates? The vertebrates are, we are vertebrates, mammals are vertebrates. Why? Because we have vertebral column. Invertebrates, these are the example of Pisces, where they don't have vertebral column. So, if you see the structure of the ground level, at the base level, you will see the structure of starfish, the snail, and then Pisces, amphibia, then reptiles, birds, apes, mammals. So all these, if you see the first section here is as Paleozoic era, then reptiles will come in Mesozoic era, and the apes, that is birds and mammals, will come in Cenozoic era. If you see the gradual development, you will see that at the base, in the structure of the ground of the earth, you will see that invertebrates, you will see fossils of the invertebrates. Then you will see the Pisces fossils first, then amphibia, then reptiles, then mammals and birds. So if you see the ground surface, and if you dig, you will see by step at various stages, you will get different fossils. And from that, the paleontologists, they came to the conclusion that vertebrates are being slowly originated from invertebrates. What you need to understand here is that if you see the paleontological evidence, if you see the structure of the fossils, vertebrates are being originated from the invertebrates, and we can say that we are having common origin. Last statement is important, that from these evidences we belong or we have the common ancestry, common origin.